Hello everyone, I am Anuj, a second year medical student at GMC Nagpur. So welcome to my channel. If you're new to this channel, I make videos on anything that would interest me and also help my juniors. So consider subscribing if you may. And I have annotations to any point of the video where you'd like to jump on. So go ahead, don't waste your time, do something more productive. Okay, so starting off with the video, the first thing I want to tell you is that when you are going to be coming to any kind of new year in your medical school, you're going to be encountering different subjects with a lot of terminologies. For example, in first year, you're going to be encountering a lot of terminologies in anatomy, then a lot of different clinical conditions in physiology, and a ton of different metabolites in biochemistry. So learning all of that can be a bit tedious at times, but here are 10 essential tips that everyone I think must follow so that they could get the most out of the little time they have in their MBBS to learn all those 19 subjects. So getting over it. The first point is called additive spatial memory. So basically, additive spatial memory is another form of memory apart from the audiovisual and the writing stuff, which actually originates in your motor cortex and not your prefrontal cortex. So what I'm trying to explain it here is that if you add a specific action along with your reading and writing stuff, you can learn things much better. For example, if I want to memorize the types of sutures present in the skull, so I would go with plain, internasal, serrate, interparietal, squamous, temporoparietal. But that is a very tedious way of learning. I could rather simplify it with plain, serrate, squamous, denticulate, which means that I don't really have to remember the name of the bones, but I could just use my actions to demonstrate them. So if someone were to ask me where the serrate suture is, I would just do it plain, serrate, squamous, denticulate, serrate. Serrate is the interparietal one. So that would really help me out. For example, I want to learn the modifications of the deep fascia. I could go with, this is the retinaculum. These are the fibrous flexure sheets between the flexor tendons. And this is the dorsal digital expansion. So if I want to quickly revise my modification of deep fascia, I could just go like, That would be all. So that thing is very useful for studying anatomy and also physiology in some cases. Second is called as retrograde learning. So everybody knows that the heart of clinical medicine or studying in any subject in MBBS is actually learning from clinical cases. What I mean is that if I were to tell you that if you go smell the breath of a diabetic person with uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, you would find that his breath is actually sweety or fruity in odor. So what we can correlate from here is that ketones have sweet odors because ketoacidosis is a condition found in uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. But if you were to just rote learn acetone is fruity in nature, you would not get it. So develop your concepts on basis of the clinical cases and not the clinical cases on basis of the concepts. So that was retrograde learning, that is learning backwards and not forwards. That is really helpful. Try it out for some time. The third point I'd like to tell you is most people don't know this, but if you are having a symbiotic memorization technique going on, it will not only help you but also your partner. So what happens is that just get a person who has almost the same or slightly more or slightly less knowledge than you in any of the subject or any of the topic that you're discussing, and then you ask each other a series of questions with different answers. So for example, if the person knows little less about anatomy than you and you go ahead and ask him, what is the nutrient artery to the tibia? If that person doesn't know it, he'll just skip it, and then you get to answer, it is the posterior tibial artery. Can you see the two-way benefit here? The person who is getting to listen all this can rethink about this exact moment where this situation happened, and he will remember forever that the nutrient artery to the tibia is the posterior tibial artery, whereas you who are explaining will also remember the same moment and know that the nutrient artery to the tibia is posterior tibial artery, whereas if you both read it somewhere, maybe 6 or 7 months later you might forget it. So do you see the benefits of symbiotic memorization? It can also be helped, it can also be used for physiology where you discuss different types of cases and different types of clinical conditions. And basically it is very helpful if you're living in the hostel, and you can ask it to many people. You can also try it with friendly seniors. That would really help. Okay. The next is the Feynman method. So the Feynman method is actually devised by a great physicist of the 20th century, that is Sir Richard Feynman. It has four stages. First step is that you grab a concept and you read thoroughly about it. The second step is that you take that concept and try to explain it to yourself or a friend in your simple language without using much terminologies. Third thing is that you find the lacunas or the places which you weren't able to explain so properly, recover them, and the fourth final explanation of the things that you learned. So that would not only help you explain better and get your viva skills nice, but since you can explain it better, you understand it very nicely. And since the third step is very crucial, that you're filling your lacunes, that means you get to pinpoint the location of the point which you didn't understand, which you can go clear out with your teachers or your seniors or even your batchmate if you're using the simultaneous memorization technique. Okay. Fifth is the most important thing, is that the law of diminishing returns. What it states is actually, it is a part of economics, but it, I think, applies to every aspect of this thing. So what it actually states is that it doesn't matter how much hours you're giving into it, it actually matters how much of productive hours you're giving into it. For example, if you want to study a thing, then take small steps every day and not one giant staircase in one day. So for example, let's say you can read 80 pages in 2 hours. The amount of information that you're going to be retaining in those first 2 hours, it's much more than the information you're going to be retaining in the next 2 hours. That means if you keep adding more hours, the amount of information that is going and retaining in your brain decreases significantly. And a point comes where there is a plateau, and after that, even a decline phase. That means if you're reading, you're just wasting time, not much information is going in, but you're actually losing the information which you first read because of too much confusion in going on. So what I would suggest it you is you break the topics and read them each day or after each particular hours, or intermingle them with different subjects. That brings us to the next topic, that is the sixth point, which I would like to highlight. Repeated spaced revisions. So repeated spaced revisions are very important for you, because if you are learning something new, first thing I would suggest is that take notes, and the first day when you first learn it, try to read the notes four times. That is, first time in the morning, second at lunch, third in the evening, and fourth at dinner. So the day one you get four reads, day two move that reads to three, that is morning, afternoon and evening. Day three move with two reads only, that is morning and evening, and day four with one read just in the afternoon. What that would do is that since each day you're reading it so many times, what happens is that your brain gets to fix whatever information it is given you in your notes into pictographic memory, but it also helps you revise a lot of things quickly. For example, it took you 30 minutes to revise your notes the first time, the first day. It would, I guess, take 25 minutes to revise it the fourth time on the first day, and it would take like 15 minutes to revise it for the only one time during the fourth day. Okay. Seventh tip that I would like to give you is synchronized reading and learning. That is, if you let's say if you're reading a thing known as transport across the membrane in physiology, and then you reach the end of the chapter and you're going to the next chapter, that is resting membrane potential. So just ask yourself anything which you found out that it was out of the topic or it was hard for you about the chapter you first read, that is membrane transport. So if you can go like, okay, so facilitated diffusion, I think GLUT4 is insulin dependent. So then think to yourself, is it true or not? And then if you find the answer to be correct, you can move on. But if not, you can go back, just read it quickly, and it will really help you. It will help you actually in two ways. If you are able to answer, then you are well and good. It will give you motivation and it will give you a way to go. And second is, if you don't get the answer, you just can go back, revise it. And while you're revising, you can also look at a few of the things that would really help. So that was synchronized reading and learning. Next is flowcharts. So the eighth point is flowcharts. Flowcharts is actually the only thing which will help you remember biochemistry. For example, if you are learning, let's say, tyrosine metabolism today, maybe 2 weeks later you might not remember it. But if you make a flowchart put that in some kind of wall where you can easily see it. For example, if there is your bed and there's your wall, then you can just put it right there. Whenever you wake up, the first thing you're going to see in the morning is that metabolism. So what that would do is that since you see it repeatedly, if you're not reading it, if there is inattentional blindness, you'll at least remember how many steps and how many things. So eventually that will lead up to adding of the memories, and then finally you can just say the tyrosine metabolism without even looking at it and without revision. But flowcharts are very important. So draw as many flowcharts as you can for as many subjects as you can, because those are like the summary, and summary is a very good thing. The ninth thing is personally a very beneficial thing for me, that is the Mozart effect. So what this technique basically says is that if any kind of music is being played while you're studying, which is soothing your brain, you will actually learn better. How it works is that if you have ever meditated, you would see that there's not much difference in calming your thoughts down by stopping them and calming your thoughts down by music. So when you're listening to pleasant music, what happens is that any other thoughts in your brain, they are suppressed. And in that suppression state, your subconscious is very active. So you can just take the information from the books and put it right there. So when you're in the nirvana stage of meditation, it has a similar effect. If you're reading while there's some form of music playing, most likely instrumental, because if you're going to be adding rap music, that's just going to be horrible because it's going to stick around. So just try to stick with pleasant music and in a low tune, but that would really help you memorize a lot of things very fast. The most important thing, or my 10th point, is actually mindset. So mindset is a very, very, very important thing that most people overlook. That is, if you go to a subject and if you want to study it, there are two ways which you can study. First way is you can just go over with the attitude to read things, and you can read them, or you can go with an attitude to learn them. If you have the later attitude, then it really becomes an interesting thing for you, and anything which interests you will retain better, because it is a well-known fact in physiology that if anything that does not have an emotional context to you will be thrown out immediately. So if you are really curious to know, curiosity does most of the work for you. Okay, so those were my top 10 picks for getting good grades in examination to help study better. They are applicable to, I guess, every subject in the world, but most importantly, I found out about them while I was studying for MBBS. So I am studying for MBBS rather. So thank you for watching this video. Thank you for the support on my previous video. It like blew me away how many people have watched that. Consider subscribing. Thank you so much.